Okay, assalamualaikum and also good morning. Cuma dekat hujung kelas nanti ingatkan saya untuk kita check balik the timetable of the lab. Okay. Sebab nampak ramai lagi tak ada di sini. Okay, kita mulakan kelas dulu. Okay, hari ini kita akan sentuh tentang face lead design. Okay, the second lecture of the chapter 10. Okay, walaupun hari itu minggu lepas saya telah sentuh sedikit banyak tentang face lead design. Okay, dan bagaimana untuk creating electrical circuit gunakan face lead design. Okay, cuma kita tak sentuh lagi tentang bagaimana untuk tentukan nilai pole, nilai zero dan juga dan nilai of the gain. Okay, so hari ini kita akan pergi detail on this. Jadi ini kalau kita rujuk pada buku section 10.5 face lead design using root locus. So the knowledge on control system, whatever chapter that we have learned before, basically will help you in understanding. Okay, the design of the face lead compensation. The design of the face lead compensation network can be readily accomplished using root locus. The face lead network has a transfer function like this. We have discussed this before last week. Okay, where basically there is an equivalent equation for tau and also alpha in the form of resistor, two resistor and one capacitor. Okay, and basically this equation can be rearranged in the form of S plus zero and then S plus divided by S plus pole. So the only thing now you need to locate where should be the zero and where should be the poles. Okay, the location of the zero and poles are selected so as to result in a satisfactory root locus for the compensated system. Okay, and the specification of the system are used to specify the desired location of dominant root of the system. Okay, so basically you need to utilize the specification given to get the area of the specification in the S plane, and then from there you need to choose a point where it should become the dominant roots. This dominant root normally is a complex roots. Okay, so once you know this, and then after that you choose this area, basically you will determine the value of Z and also value of P. Okay, this is the step by step approach to the face lead design. Okay, the first step that you need to do, okay, first list the system specification and translate them into a desired location for the dominant roots. Okay, I will explain further later for this thing. And then second step, sketch the uncompensated root locus and determine whether the desired root location can be realized with an uncompensated system. That means if we can realize that, so we don't need further step. Okay, so you just need to select the gain and then that's it. Okay, but we need to go to further step if the uncompensated root locus does not go into the area of the specification. So if a compensator is necessary, place the zero of the face lead network directly below the desired root location. Okay, because once you have done the step one, the area of the specification, okay, you should select the dominant roots location. Okay, And then once you know the dominant root location, okay, and then you can place the zero, okay, where the real part of the zero should be same as the real part of the desire of the dominant root location. And then after that, the step number four, determine the pole location so that the total angle at the root location is 180 degree and therefore is on the compensated root location. Okay? Once you have determined the zero location, after that you can locate the pole location, okay, based on the angle criterion. And then after that, evaluate the total system gain at the desired root location and then calculate the error constant. So basically here you need to calculate the gain value at the location of the dominant root location, and once you get the value of the gain, you can use with the value of gain to calculate the error constant. Do you still remember in chapter 5 we learn about position error constant, velocity error constant, and acceleration error constant? So we learn all that constant in relation to the steady state error, right? Because last time we did simplify that the equation of the steady state error, depending on the process transfer function, where S equal to S to the power of N. Okay, according to the N, the value of the N, okay, the steady state error can either be zero, or it can become infinity, or it can become a constant. And the constant is depending if you implementing a step response, a step input, or ramp input, okay, and the other one, parabolic input. So there are three types of input. So basically this, the step number five is in relation to check what is the value of the steady state error if you have three type of input. And normally the steady state error will be given as the transfer will be given as specification. Okay, the only thing, we cannot sketch the steady state error in the S plane. Okay, the first step when we translate the specification into the into S plane, basically that is normally the performance measure of the percentage of overshoot and settling time. Okay, you can draw it in the S plane and then you get the area. Okay, but for steady state error, you cannot draw it in the S plane. That's why after you get all the system parameter, after that you need to check, because if your specification given, okay, are listed also the steady state error, so you should check whether this will fulfill the steady state error specification or not. And then step six, repeat the step if the error constant is not satisfactory. Okay, this means if you calculate the error constant, okay, and it doesn't fulfill the specification given, okay, you can redo back this step, all the steps, okay, because here basically when in step one, when you choosing the dominant roots location, you just choose one point in the specification area. So you can choose another point and try it again. Okay? Okay, for the step one, locate the desired root location for the dominant roots. Normally in this step, we know that in performance measure, there are 5 performance measure, okay, that can be given, okay, for S specification, okay. And normally, for this step one, normally if it is given the percentage of overshoot and also the settling time, and then you can plot the area in the S plane, okay. For example, if you are given the percentage of overshoot, okay, because from percentage of overshoot equation, okay, it's only dependent on the zeta, right? So from that percentage of overshoot, you can calculate what is the value of zeta. And then once you get the zeta, because the zeta is basically equal to cos theta, this is the angle of theta. So basically, if you know what is the percentage of overshoot, should be less than something value, okay, you will calculate that the zeta should be greater than something. So that value of the zeta, you can calculate the angle of theta there, and then draw a line of zeta. Okay, so whatever is in this side, basically is the area. And another specification that normally given is the settling time. You know the settling time, the equation for settling time for 2% is equal to 4 divided by zeta omega n. And basically, with that, if the settling time is given, basically you will know the value of zeta multiplied by omega n. And zeta multiplied by omega n normally will become the real part of the complex root. The value of zeta omega n normally will indicate the value in the real axis. So if you know that value, just find that value in the axis and then just draw vertical line. Draw a vertical line which is equal to that one. Okay, but it is not a vertical line, it is actually a curve, okay, where you know that if you have a roots, okay, the distance from origin to here is omega n, and it is basically a circle with a radius of omega n, okay. But never mind, if you draw that a line also, that's good enough. So by doing that, basically, for example, let's say actually when we convert from the root location to zeta and omega n, basically the root location is actually in Cartesian coordinate, and zeta and omega n is theta and omega n basically is a polar coordinate, because for example if we having root here, okay, the radius is omega n and this one is theta, so that is in polar coordinate. But in Cartesian coordinates, basically the real axis is what value and also the imaginary axis is what value. So basically, once you know that, basically you have the either line or curve due to the settling time, okay, so any area greater than that curve should be the area of the settling time. And if you have the percentage of overshoot, you have a line like this, and any area along that is the area of the percentage of overshoot less than and the specified overshoot. Okay, so now you have the area, okay, and then once you have that area, okay, select the dominant roots location somewhere in that area, Okay, you can pick any point in that area. Okay, at the border also okay. Okay, normally if you select the point, select the point in the area where the number easy for you to calculate. Okay, so that later on your calculation will be easier. Okay, for example, maybe if this is for example 45, maybe if this one is already 1 or 2, maybe you just select this point so that it is the maybe if zeta multiplied by omega n is 2, and then here also will become 2. Okay, but you can select any point as long as in the area for the desired roots. That means later on, if we get our root on that location, it will fulfill the specification based on the percentage overshoot and also based on the settling time. So you can follow? Okay, later on we do an example on that. Okay, after that, what you need to do, you need to sketch the uncompensated root locus. When you have the transfer function for the plant, for the process, okay, use it to draw your uncompensated root locus. Okay, for example, maybe you have a plant with 3 poles, okay, and without no zero, and then when you plot the root locus look like this. If you compare back with your desired location, because this is your desired root location, and if you compare with this root locus, okay, compare it whether the root locus is crossing that desired root location. In this case, does it crossing or not? Okay, because the desired root location we select somewhere here, right? Okay, so that means your root locus doesn't cross that desired root location. So that means you need to proceed for the next. You need to add the compensator for the system, so that later on it will change your root locus, okay, to cross your desired location. Okay, if we need to proceed to step 3, okay, if we need to add the compensator, okay, first of all we need to add the zero, okay, we need to add a zero on the real axis. Okay, to add the zero is easy. If you have already decided the desired root location here, okay, just put it below it. Usually we put just exactly below. The real part is always same. But sometimes if there is another pole here, maybe we offset a little bit. But in this case, basically, because we just want to show you it won't overlap with the poles. If it's overlap also, it's okay. Okay, the only thing, because here just to see that there is a pole and zero here. Okay, so you have the desired roots, just locate it below it. So that means the real part of the zero will be the same as the real part of the desired root location, the dominant roots. Okay, so by that step, you already got the value of the Z. And then after that, once you have get this one, okay, of course when we do the face lead design, the pole we need to locate somewhere on the left of the zero, okay, somewhere in this side, okay, because this is face lead. If face lag, we put this side, but for face lead, we put it this side. Okay, the only thing how to calculate exactly the location of the poles, you need to use the angle criterion. The angle criterion basically, because we have the root location here, you can calculate the angle to each pole, the angle here, angle 1, angle 2, angle 3, okay, and then minus the angle 0 of the 0, and then this one, angle of the new poles. So basically, you will have negative 180 equal to negative this angle 1, pole 1, angle of pole 2, angle of pole 3, angle of pole 4, okay, plus the angle of 0. Negative 180 degree minus pole 1 minus pole angle of pole 2 minus pole angle of pole 3 minus angle of pole 4 and then plus angle of pole 0. Okay, and through the triangulation, because you know the position of this one already, you know the position of each pole, you know the position of each zero. Okay, so you can calculate the angle through triangulation. Okay, and then calculate the unknown angle is only this one, the last pole. Okay, the rest of the angle you know, so now you can calculate that angle. And then once you get this angle using the triangulation, you will get the location of the P of the pole. Okay, so by this step basically you get the location of the pole. So now basically your parameter has been designed. Okay, you have your zero and location of your poles. Let's look at an examples. This is in the books, example 10.3. Okay, we have a system, lead compensator, using root lockers, where we have a system with a closed loop system like this. Okay, the only thing this system is given that the specification of the system, the given specification is that the PO is 30, should be less or equal to 35%. And then the settling time should be less than 4 seconds. The only thing we know from the percentage of overshoot, we have the equation of the percentage of overshoot for second order. Okay, which is 100 multiplied by exponential of minus zeta multiplied by pi divided by square root of 1 minus zeta square. Okay, so if we know the PO should be 35%, okay, we just put it here, and then we can find the value of zeta. Okay, if we calculate that, we will find that the zeta should be greater or equal than 0.32. Okay, and with this value of the zeta, we can find the value of the theta, the angles, which is we just take the r cosine of 0.32. Okay, if we calculate that, the angle should be less than or equal to 71 degree. Okay, the angles. So the only thing, be careful with the symbols, because when you use the greater than symbol or less than, okay, because the relation of the PO and also the zeta is reverse. Okay, because if you increase the PO, the zeta will reduce. Okay, similarly also the theta, you should be careful as well, because theta and zeta also, the because the zeta here is 1, and when you go here, it'll become 0 here. Okay, but for the theta, here is 0, and when you go here, it's 90 degree. So the relation is reverse. Okay, so be careful with the symbol of greater or less. Okay, so for this case, basically the area based on PO should be in the white area here. Okay, on this side of the line, because it should be less than or equal to 71 degree. And then after that, the settling time The settling time given is force should be greater or less or equal to 4 seconds. So the equation of settling time, if we use 2% criterion, is this equation 4 divided by zeta omega n. So this equation is equal to, it should be greater, should be less or equal than 4. So from here you find that zeta multiplied by omega n should be greater or equal to 1. So this value is basically we just in the real axis here, the value of 1 here. So we just draw a line here. Okay, we just draw a vertical line along the 1, and the white area here, okay, which show the area of greater than that value. Okay, so if we combine these two specifications, basically we get this area, the white one. Okay, so that means if we want to fulfill the specification of the percentage of overshoot and also the settling time, we should select the roots somewhere in this white area. You can select the desired roots, okay, anywhere, either inside or at the border. Okay, the only thing in this case to make easier calculation, I just select the one at border here where the real part is 1. Okay, you can select this point as well. Okay, but this point, because this is 2 point something something, so maybe later on it's difficult for you to calculate. Okay, just find the exact value, it's easier for you to calculate somewhere here. Okay, 1, and the imaginary part is 2. Okay, negative 1 plus and minus j multiplied by 2. Okay, so that later on easier for you to calculate. Okay, the only thing, if you select that point as your desired root location, okay, you can calculate, you can translate to the polar coordinate, okay, where your omega n basically is, basically if you have this, the omega n basically is this distance from the origin to your desired pole. And that one basically, if you have the real part here, your imaginary part here, so you just square both of them and plus, so you get the diagonal, and then take a square root. Okay, you get the diagonal. So that is the distance, which is the omega n. And then once you know this one, the distance of this, you know that zeta is basically equal to cos theta. Okay, and cos theta is basically because you know this one in the real axis, this one is equal to 1, and then you have calculated the omega n. So 1 divided by omega n basically equal to cos theta or equal to zeta, right? Okay, and if you calculate that, you get the zeta at that particular location is 0.45. And then after that, the second step, okay, the second step, let's say for your plan here, the process, you have the transfer function Gs equal to K1 divided by S square, and the Hs is equal to 1. So basically from this equation, from this block diagram, you got your transfer function is equal to G multiplied by H divided by 1 plus GH. Okay, that's why your characteristic equation is equal to 1 plus G multiplied by H. The only thing, H is equal to 1 and G is K1 divided by S square. So you have your equation, characteristic equation like this. 1 plus K1 divided by S square. So if you look at this characteristic equation, basically how many poles we have there? We have 2 poles. Okay? And how many zero? Okay, there is no zero. Okay. So, the location of the pole is where? Okay, both of them is located at origin. Right. Okay. So, both of them are located here. Okay. And since you have no zero, okay, so you have two locus. Okay. You have SL is equal to number of pole, 2. And because you don't have any zero, so you have two asymptote as well. Okay? And if you calculate the asymptote, center, the asymptote center will be somewhere here also at the origin. And the breakaway point also, if you calculate, is somewhere there. And then if you calculate the angle, basically one of them is 90 degrees, the other one is negative 90 degrees. Okay? So this is your root locus. Starting from here, it just meet together and then one of them is break out upward and then the other one is break out downward. Okay? And now if you compare with your specification, your desired root location, is one of them is here that you decided just now. Okay? Negative 1 plus J2, which is here. Okay? So, if you compare that, does your uncompensated root locus passing through that desired location? No. Okay? It doesn't pass through. Okay? Not only that, even your root locus not even go into this area. Okay? That's why for this case, okay, you need to add the compensator. Okay? You need to add the compensator so that your root locus will pass through your desired location. Okay, this is the step 3. Okay, for the step 3, we need to decide on the location of the zero. Okay? Where we know that the compensator transfer function will be S plus Z divided by S plus P. The only thing we need to decide first, the location of the zero. Okay? And in this case, okay, we have already decided the location of the desired root in step 1. Okay? The only thing for the location of Z, what we have said before in that step, the location of the zero should be below the desired root location. Okay? So if the root location having the real part is negative 1, so your zero also should become negative 1, located at the real axis. So you have your, now you decided that your zero should be negative 1. Put it there. So you complete the step 3. And then go to step 4. Okay, in step 4, okay, we need to locate the pole location. Okay, for the pole location, okay, the pole should be on the real axis and on the left of the zero. Okay, the only thing we need to know exactly where the location of the P on the left of the zero. Okay, so what you can do here, you use the angle criterion. Okay, we calculate the angle here. The only thing, remember, here you have a double pole here. Okay, so there should be angle here. If you calculate this angle from this is trigonometry, basically you will find that this angle is 160. And then you have this angle, which you need to find later on. Okay? Angle of the new poles. And then you have the angle of the zero. Angle of the zero, since we put just below it, basically it's easy. Okay? It is 90 degrees. Okay? So that's why we put here, okay, negative 116. Okay, remember, because there are two poles here, That's why we multiply by 2. And then the pole should be negative. Okay. And then negative of the new poles. Okay, minus the new pole angles. And then plus the angle of the zero. Okay. And this should be equal to negative 180 degree. Okay. So you will, if you the only unknown here is theta p. So now you can find the theta p. It should be equal to 38 degree. Okay. And once you know this angle of theta p, okay. Okay, from this angle, okay, you can find the distance from here to here. Okay, because you know this angle and you know this height already. So you can use the tangent to find this distance. Okay, but don't forget to add this distance as well. Okay. So this distance plus this distance. Okay, so that basically the location of the P. Okay, so the 2 is here, the 2 is the height here. Okay, and then when we multiply with this, basically we get this one. Okay, the only thing I forgot here, it should be plus 1. Okay, because otherwise if we calculate this only, I think it's only minus 2.6. Okay. After we plus 1, it become negative 3.6. Okay? So now this is your pole. Location of pole. So now with that, you complete your compensator. Your compensator will be S plus 1, because your 0 is located at negative 1. And divided by S plus 3.6, because your pole is located at negative 3.6. Okay, then after that, the fifth step is to find the gain value. Okay, of course, after you know your compensator GC, just add in the equation. The only thing, after you add your characteristic equation like this, you know that the only unknown is the gain K1. Okay, and this one, if from this characteristic equation, if you find the magnitude, okay, you just bring a 1 to this side, become negative 1, and bring this one to this side, and bring this one to this side, and then take the absolute. So basically the K1 should be equal to the distance from the roots to the poles. Okay, this is square because there are two poles here. Okay, the distance from the zero to the pole. Okay, and then this one also, the distance from this is roots to the poles. Okay, so that is the distance. And this one is basically the distance from the roots to the zero. Okay, because this distance is 2, right? Okay. And then you calculate that, you get the K1 equal to 8.1. If you have grid here, maybe you can just measure. Okay. But otherwise, you can calculate by triangulation. Okay, all this distance. Since we have our transfer function like this, okay, you notice that the n, s to the power of n, is equal to 2. So when n is equal to 2, we know that the steady state error is equal to 0 and kp is equal to infinity. And the kv is also equal to infinity, and the steady state error is equal to 0. The only thing is that when n is equal to 2, the Ka should equal to constant. Okay? And the steady state error will become a constant. Okay? The only thing, this one, Ka, you check back in chapter 5, how to calculate the Ka. Basically, it's you're taking limit as approaching 0, s square minus gs. Okay? That's why you got this one become 0, this one become 0, and s square will cancel out with the s square. Okay? So this one become 1, this one become 3.6, that's why we get this one. Okay? And the K is 8.1 that we have just now. Okay? From that, we got 2.55. And the steady state error basically is equal to A divided by 2.25. Okay? So, now if you calculate that, this will become 0.44A. That means is that the error is 44%. Okay? The steady state error is 44%. Okay? So check with the specification. Of course, here is in this example, it's not given the specification. Check this specification. If it is okay, acceptable, and then you stop there. Okay? Otherwise, maybe you select, you need to repeat again. Okay? If you need to repeat, okay, select other location of the roots inside the specification area. Maybe you select somewhere here or somewhere here, as long as in the area. Okay? And try again. Okay? Until when you come to the step 5, it fulfills the specification. So basically, what you have learned, the design of the phase lead compensation network can be readily accomplished using root lockers. 6 steps involved in a phase lead design. Design phase lead compensator using root lockers method. So this will become foundation for designing feedback control system. Any question on this design? On the phase lead design?